A few months ago, we spoke about the mineral wheel, how hard it is to balance those minerals, not really being specific about where to get each individual mineral. And today, I'm going to explain where each one naturally occurs, as well as how to get it realistically in our modern diets. And this is coinciding with the various supplements I released on organ supplements earlier this week, as there weren't supplements on the market that made this practical, mainly due to artificially high dosage. So starting with calcium, it's not really present in high amounts in any ancestral diet. Dairy isn't consumed by all cultures, and the form of calcium in plant foods is bound to oxalate anti-nutrients, doesn't really get absorbed. In a perfect world, you wouldn't need that much calcium. That's why human breast milk is relatively low in calcium, whereas cow's milk is incredibly high. Think about the bone density of a cow versus a human. You know, most people actually don't need any calcium, but if you were carnivore, which is high in phosphorus, an antagonist to calcium, you might have to increase your calcium intake for a few months. I personally used a high calcium mineral water, such as Gerolsteiner, and I started feeling a lot better, which only took a couple of weeks. But once I reduced my meat intake, it wasn't really necessary to continue taking calcium. I don't recommend supplements. There's nothing really available or practical. If you do tolerate dairy, that is an option. Copper is present in high amounts in certain seafood, salmon, shellfish, which is unfortunately polluted to the point where I don't really think it's safe to eat those foods, let alone on a consistent basis. Certain plant foods like mushrooms and chocolate do have copper on paper. They would have been higher in the wild or grown in better soil, but don't digest too well because they are in the plant form. Some people can't really absorb it too well. Regardless, whether you're coming from a standard American or carnivore diet, you likely have to supplement initially. It's deficient in the former, and zinc imbalances copper in the latter. I took 6 milligrams per day, sometimes even 8 for a month. Then I went down to about 4 milligrams per day for a few months. And now I'm taking 2 to 3 milligrams a few times a week at most. I do have some chocolate here and there. I do have potatoes, mushrooms, some higher copper plant foods. Manganese is similar to copper in a sense that it's high in that ocean food as well as certain plant foods. Similarly to copper, as well as calcium, it's low on a beef-only carnivore diet, and most people develop deficiencies on carnivore. My trace mineral supplement has 3 milligrams of manganese, which is the average amount you would get by consuming foods such as pine nuts, brown rice, lima beans, and pineapple. You really have to have quite a variety of high-quality foods in your diet to really check all the boxes for certain minerals. Magnesium might be the most important and most difficult mineral to get. It is depleted in soil first. We need it in a fairly high volume compared to other supplements. Usually, if you take copper, manganese, iodine, any of these other minerals, it's a relatively small pill, but to get the amount of magnesium you need on a daily basis, you know, you're taking 3, 4 very large pills. Translate that to food, difficult if not impossible to get. You need it for vitamin D3 absorption, calcium metabolism. It's one of the few minerals that I recommend people take on a consistent basis over several months initially. I guess the same could be said with iodine, which is well known to be in seafood, but as we said earlier, pollution concerns. We did a video several months back going in depth on that. Dairy and eggs do have iodine if they're high quality grass-fed. Since the pollutant halogens, fluoride, chlorine, and bromide are so common, we typically need higher iodine levels anyway, consistently. I formulated one on organ supplements to be 150 micrograms per day transdermal, which is equivalent to eating one serving of seafood. Next up, we have potassium, which there really is plenty of as long as you're eating high quality, whole natural foods. I did a video titled Stop Worrying About Potassium, where I explain that further. Phosphorus is ample in dairy and meat, and since most of us are consuming a base diet of high quality animal foods, it's not necessary to supplement. Next up, we have sulfur. This is another problematic mineral on carnivore, even vegan diets. Meat, eggs, dairy, cruciferous vegetables, all incredibly high in sulfur. One mineral we don't have on here is molybdenum, which is antagonistic to sulfur and something that's high in legumes, lentils, peas, beans. And I put molybdenum in the trace mineral supplement. in the naturally occurring amount if you ate those foods on a consistent basis. Cobalt, like sulfur, is ample in meat, not really a concern in getting enough of it. It's bound to B12, and some of you may be familiar with, you know, methylcobalamin or cobalamin supplements. That's referencing cobalt bound to those B vitamins. If you do have malabsorption or gut issues, this is where you might actually want to supplement some B vitamins, but cobalt isn't really necessary. On to zinc, which is very high on carnivore, probably deficient on a standard American diet. I definitely wouldn't supplement zinc coming from a carnivore diet. And if you do ever supplement zinc in any context, you definitely want to take a coinciding amount of copper with it. You know, the average person eating high quality animal foods that doesn't have gut issues is going to be absorbing plenty of zinc in their diet. We don't really have to touch on sodium. I've done several videos on salt. You just want to add salt on your food to taste, 1-to-1 ratio of sodium to potassium preferably, but your body will get there naturally with its cravings. You know, you might have prosciutto one day and then you don't want salt for a couple days. You know, it's sea salt, any high quality salt, Himalayan salt, very easily accessible, doesn't have to be supplemented. Last but not least, we have iron. And from my videos about iron, you guys are probably familiar with iron overload. And the problem with minerals like iron and calcium is there are so many other nutrients required for proper metabolism and absorption that the imbalances in our modern world result in liver iron overload or calcification of various tissues. You might need to donate blood if your ferritin or iron blood work is elevated, but that's a bit more involved, and you can watch my videos on that. Selenium was not on the mineral wheel, but I think it's the most overlooked mineral. Really helped me with my liver function. It's antagonistic to mercury and sulfur, which can be high on certain carnivore diets. One main symptom of selenium deficiency is infertility, which is probably why a lot of carnivore dieters lose their sex drive when eating only beef. I have a separate supplement for selenium itself in a dose that you would get from eating seafood or nuts, which are typically polluted or have toxins like mold. So in the case of some of these mineral powder supplements, even though they're synthetically made in a laboratory, it's still better than poisoning yourself with our modern food supply and not having a guarantee of absorbing them. Brazil nuts, organic, high quality, maybe it's okay. You can try them compared to a supplement. It's up to you. We didn't touch on boron either, and I think the boron bros are gonna hang me up if I don't talk about it. So I did put boron in my trace mineral supplement along with the molybdenum and the manganese, as I figured it's the only remaining mineral that you can't guarantee in your diet. I honestly don't think boron is necessary for most people, maybe supplementing a few times a year, but there are so many reported benefits of supplementing boron that I haven't experienced myself. I don't know if it's a bunch of people trying to sell boron or it actually worked for them. So you could follow a balanced diet, focus on those foods I mentioned, and the majority of you would have all the nutrients you need in 6 months to a year, depending on past deficiencies. That is, if you don't have gut issues and everything was in check, which it likely isn't. And that's why having supplements with basically guaranteed bioavailability and absorption is a quick way to fix some health issues in months as opposed to years. Now, I would have never fixed my histamine intolerance without copper supplements and, you know, a few other things like the selenium that I mentioned, the magnesium. All of these have helped me greatly. You know, it takes weeks to months of consuming a food to see results from it. So by having access to these supplements, yeah, it's kind of like a double-edged sword. If you know what you're doing, it's great. If you don't know what you're doing, you can cause further issues. So thank you guys for joining me today. This was a little longer than I anticipated, so we'll wrap it up now. And if you guys do have any questions, please leave them down below. If you guys feel like I missed anything, please let me know. My brain is fried because too much stuff going on. So you guys can go to organsupplements.com to see the minerals I have available. You guys can go to frank-tufano.com to see all of my other businesses. Frankie's arranged me for high-quality animal foods. And hopefully, in the relatively near future, I can start providing you guys with high-quality versions of all of these foods that you can do to encapsulate complete human nutrition. So thanks again for joining me, guys, and I'll see you for tomorrow's video.